अनंत सगरी मागरी बनीस
Namaskaram and welcome back to A Carnatic Journey. We saw in the last episode how Manodharma plays such an important part in concert singing, and the reason that a concert is so exciting and so innovative each time for you listeners and for us musicians is definitely because of the Manodharma quotient in a concert. There are so many aspects to this Kalpana Sangeeta part of our Indian music, and one of the main reasons why our music is so very unique. Of course, throughout this journey we kept revisiting the fact that the raga is the pivotal part of our Carnatic music, or Indian music for that matter. Ours is raga music. And in the concert scenario, when you step into a concert, one of the most important aspects of Manodharma, that is the creative part of our music, is perhaps the raga alapana. The expansive way in which a musician can create the different myriad shades of a particular raga can create different moods in different people, isn't it so? For some people, it can completely calm them down, make them very meditative. For others, it is so exciting and interesting. Though all these ragas give different moods to different people, there are certain inherent qualities to many of these ragas, and you would have noticed them mostly when the musician goes into a raga alapana, because it is the alapana which is the most free flowing part of our Manodharma Sangeeta. It is not bound by words, lyrics or laya to a great extent, and a musician can use his or her imagination to weave the different moods of the raga, of course within the grammar of the raga, but there are no other boundaries, and the artist can express oneself with unfettered imagination. We are also not bound by any other idea other than what has been absorbed by the musician over the years and what has been taught to them and what they have derived out of the different kirtanas and compositions that they have learnt over the years. That is the reason why the different colors of the raga are seen when different artists perform. You can visualize colors, different moods. That is why many of these ragas are associated to seasons, they are associated to time of the day. For instance, when you hear a saveri, or a reva gupti, all these things make us think about dawn, about early morning. So they are generally morning ragas. Of course, in Carnatic music, we are not bound so much by these boundaries, and we do sing many ragas at different parts of the day. But you will notice in Hindustani music, they are very particular about singing ragas at a particular time of the day. And then you have ragas which are associated with the seasons. Such is the beauty of the raga quotient in our music. And you will find that it blossoms during the raga alapana in a concert. Carnatic music, that is the six big ragas that you will find in most of the concerts: Bhairavi, Kamboji, Kalyani, Todi, Shankarabharana, Karagarapriya. Other than these big six ragas, there are many, many other ragas that can be expanded extensively. Natakurunji, Begada, Shanmugapriya, Pantuvarali, Keeravani, Bilahari, you could go on and on. There are so many ragas in the pentatonic scale also that can be expanded extensively, like Mohanam, which is everybody's favorite, even Hindolam. You will find that these kind of ragas are dealt with in a big way in most of the concerts. Let me read something from one of my music books for you. Professor Sri Sambhamurthy sir says in his South Indian music book, "Prosperity remembers with pride such names as Todi Sitaramaya, who sang the Todi Raga for 8 days and broke all previous records, and who, once being in want, was obliged to pledge his favorite Todi and raise a loan from a jealous musician." Of course, we have heard the story that a zamindar quickly paid back the loan because he so badly wanted to hear that Todi again. Atana Appaya, Shankarabaranam Narasaya, Narayana Gaula Kuppayar, who is none other than our own Veena Kuppayar, Begada Subramanyayar, you know him, Patnam Subramanyayar was called by that name because he sang Begada so beautifully. And we had Todi Sundara Rao, who were all specialists in the alapana of the respective ragas and who made them the subject of their exclusive and intensive study. Of course, we have also heard about how Saint Tyagaraja sang Devagandhari for almost 8 days when he visited Kovur. Interesting, isn't it? And then you have ragas which are inherently leisurely and calm by nature. Neelambari, Yedukula Kambodi, Dujavanti, Sahana. They all have an inherent pace about them. And you would have noticed how the mind calms down. And it has been proved in research that many of these ragas have curative properties about them. We already saw about that. Then of course we have, on the contrary, we have ragas like ragas like Athana, Bilahari, Darbar. They have an inherent pace about them. They have a mood about them. Atana is said to be authoritative. That is why you would find many kirtanas which seek attention have been tuned in Atana. Then you have ragas like Danyasi, Mukhari. Some of these ragas have a very, very classical flavor about them. And these ragas are very important in our Carnatic music concerts to lend the classical flavor to the concert. Some of these ragas, when they are sung, they take us back in time and they take us back through decades. And you get the feeling when somebody comes up, they say, "I felt like I heard concerts from the early 40s. Why do they say that? Because the kind of classical flavor that these ragas give, that is why they are very, very important quotients in a concert. Of course, now many light ragas have found their way into even ragam tanam pallavis. However, these kind of classical ragas have to be handled, at least one of these have to be handled in every concert. That will lend a beautiful flavor to the concert. So, you will notice how an artist launches into the raga, giving you a clear indication of what raga they are going to sing. For instance, na ta na ra ra na. Then you know it is Begada which is coming, right? And then they start giving you the Ranjaka Prayogas, the Gamakas, and the landmark phrases of the particular raga. And they take you along this journey. It is like going through green fields with peacocks dancing and a deer watching. There might be a waterfalls here. It lends ourselves to so much imagination and so much visualization. That is the beautiful thing about a raga alapana. And the musician themselves go into a new journey every time they try even the same raga. So how do we expand a raga alapana? Generally, we give the opening phrase and then we move into the Ranjaka Prayogas, the Gamakas, which are very characteristic of the raga, and we give some landmark phrases. Of course, we discussed this in the last episode as to how the compositions, especially of the immortal composers like the Trinity, how they give us landmark phrases from which we can borrow for the raga alapana. And we add our own imagination and weave the raga. For instance, just for students, somebody has requested me to talk about Karagarapriya, so we will take that. So, the beginning of the raga, which is in the lower octaves, there Tyagaraja Swami has given us a beautiful example. Samanam varu. So, tadarana. We have to choose a phrase that is very, very reflective of that raga, so that immediately the listener knows what raga we are singing. Tadarana. Na 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 ra ra. Then we weave around here and then we move on. Ta da ra la na ra. I am very sure your guru would tell you which are the important swaras in which you can do your nyasam, where you can stop and where we can do the gamakams. Here that could be a lead for us. These things come to us subconsciously because we have learned these compositions over the years. And then what we fill in between that? Part when you're singing it in the concert, due to paucity of time, I am not singing the raga in all its expanse. But that is how we generally develop a raga, and then we stop in the sarjam and sing some phrases there and then move on to the tarasthayi. Na a re la a re na a na re a So we can use all the practice that we've done, the sadhakam, the varisais that we've done. Na re na na re na 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 re na re na 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 re. Diga diga maga 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 da da ni da ni sa ni da ni ni da ni da ni ga ni ga sa ga ni da ni da ma ga ni sa. All these things what we practice with the varishais, they will come of use in the alapana. And then we finish with a flourish. We do a makutam, we go right on top, we do all the tarasthayi prayogas, and then we come and we finish the raga with some of the characteristic phrases. Sometimes we do a kind of finish here. Na na re 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 a na 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 re mo ta da re na re 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 mo ta re na 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 Sometimes the same raga can be sung in 2 minutes, it can be sung for 20 minutes, it all depends upon the duration that we want to sing the raga for. But there are certain ragas like Neelambari and Yadukula Kambodhi, and there are many ragas like that which if we keep on singing for a long time, it will sound very repetitive. Of course, this we've talked about Sampurna ragas. What about Asampurna ragas? If they are let us say symmetric ragas, like any pentatonic scale, like Mohanam. A re re ta re 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 na re 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 re. This is rather simple because it is symmetrical and we don't have any difference between the Aroganam and the Avaroganam. We go up the same way and rather come down the same way. So the root is known to us very well. Once we understand the Aroganam, Avaroganam and some compositions and the Varnam in this particular raga. But what happens when it is in a raga which is not symmetric? Let us take a raga like Kamala Manohari or a raga like Jagan Mohini, which is an allied raga. Handling these ragas, it would be very nice if we can practice a little bit with the swarams. The Aroganam, Avaroganam has to be understood very well, isn't it? So we can practice a little bit with the swaram and then we can launch into the alapana. I will give you a small example. So we will take Kamala Manohari. Sa ga ma pa ni sa sa ni da pa ma ga sa. So we have a daivatam there in the return, in the Avaroganam. So we of course we have beautiful composition to fall back on. Kanjadalayatakshi. And it is replete with raga, and therefore we can use that as the basis. Ta da ra na ra 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 na ha ra 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 na na ra na ha ra nam ga ma pa ni ra pa ma ga. We have to be conscious to do that kind of phrasing there. So for this kind of raga, for a student, it will be good for them to start practicing the swaram. Pada pa ma ga, ga ma pa ni da pa ma ga ma da pa ma ga pa ma ga sa ni sa ga ma ga sa. This is just a small example. There are innumerable ragas like that. which have to be practiced till they are perfect. And then you have to add the Ranjaka Prayogas, for which these Kirtanas come in handy, and they are a very important tool for us to understand the raga. Have you always wondered how it is that artists reciprocate and respond to each other and seem to intuitively understand what is going on stage? It would be wonderful to know how an artist prepares for such a scenario, and we're very happy that senior violinist Mysore Sri Srikant accepted to be part of ACJ and answer some of our questions. Let us welcome him now. Namaskaram. I'm so happy that you're here.
Namaskaram Gayatri ji. Thanks for inviting me to be part of ACJ. I'm really very happy. Thank you.
Very often, Rasikas and students wonder how it is that artists prepare for a scenario when they come across something totally new on stage. I'm sure this entails many, many years of sadhana and listening. We would like to know your thoughts about this.
Thank you, Gayatri ji. That's a very interesting question. Basically, as an accompanist, the violinist needs to be very alert on stage all the time and has to be completely focused. So, usually, like, if he would have learnt a lot of ragas and kritis from his guru. So, but sometimes we do encounter kritis that we have never heard before, or ragas that we have never heard before on stage. So how do we prepare for that? So suppose whenever we listen to any concerts, firstly the students have to listen to a lot of concerts, like concerts and recordings. Whenever we listen to a recording, whenever we come across a new raga or a new kriti, we have to try to learn that kriti, that new raga. If we cannot learn the kriti, at least we have to figure out the raga murchanas in that raga, the swaras in that raga, and the avarohana, arohana, avarohana. There are lots of books available. So suppose somebody has sung a kriti in, say, some raga, raga panchara or dundubi or some such raga, which you wouldn't have learned. So you need to figure out the arohanam, avarohanam for that raga. So it's like a constant, you have to keep constantly working at it, because there's so much to learn. So you cannot rest. So the violinist has to be very alert, and suppose after having all that, there are still some ragas that you won't know. So on stage, the artist might sing something created by himself, or something really new.
Yeah.
Still you have to be able to play without having known that on stage. You have to be able to play. You have to be able to play it in such a way that if you play a solo, if somebody asks you to play a solo, you have to be able to play a ragam tanam pallavi in that raga, which you have never played before. So that's the sort of training that a student has. Every student, irrespective of being a violinist, even a vocalist or any artist, even a main artist, main veena artist, has to. If he does this, that's great. So it's not too difficult. If you figure out the swaras and the murchanas, we can play a very decent raga. We can put it in the Carnatic template and give the gamakas, the Carnatic actual gamakas, and we can play a raga and thanam and pallavi quite simply. It's not a very big deal. So that's the way for ragas. And for swaras, of course, we have to keep constantly working. We have to, not everybody sings sarvalagu swaras. We have to work for both sarvalagus and kanakas, and we have to learn some of the kanakas, and I keep telling this again and again, we have to be very alert on stage. Whatever the, sometimes the main artists will discuss with the pakavadyam what swaras they are going to sing, what kanaki, what main korvai they are going to sing, or even what pallavi they are going to sing. But a lot of times it will be spontaneous. They themselves won't have decided what to sing, and it will be very spontaneous. And the violinist has to be, both the violinist and the mridangist have to be very alert and prepared for all this. So it's a constant improvement.
So
we have to keep
sadhana.
Yeah, we have to keep improving, and there is no stopping. It's not like I have finished my 10th standard or 12th standard exams and I can forget whatever I learnt here. We keep going back to the basics all the time. Even after having played like thousands of concerts, we have to go back to the basics and learn whatever we've done. So probably I'll speak about Pallavis and how we handle Pallavis and stuff when we come to
That'll
Pallavis
be fantastic.
Later. Thank you.
And of course, there has been another interesting question from our friend Sri Krishna Swami from Delhi. And he has asked about Janaranjani and its allied ragas. It would be great if you can explain this to him.
Sure. Like there are several sets of allied ragas, say for example Saranga and Amir Kalyani, or like I said, Madhyamavati and Vrindavana Saranga and Vrindavana. In fact, Madhyamavati and Vrindavana Saranga have the same arohanam, avarohanam. Sa sa re ma pa ni sa sa ni pa ma re sa. It's the same for both Madhyamavati and Vrindavana Saranga. How do we differentiate?
Yeah.
So it's the way the raga is handled. Sa re ma pa ni sa ra 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 ra. Madhyamavati. So if we, the way we employ the gamakas in a raga is how we differentiate, and how even a rasika can differentiate whether, even for Vrindavana Saranga, sa re ma pa ni sa sa ni pa ma re sa, it's the same note set of saras in the same order. So for Vrindavana Saranga, re ma pa ni sa ri sa pa ni pa ma pa re 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 sa ri. So just like this, of course, when we are on this page, we can even talk about Vrindavani. Re ma pa ni sa sa ni pa ma re sa. Re ma pa ni sa sa ni pa ma re ga re sa. Sri Ragam.
Yes.
Mani Rangu. So there are lots of similar ragas.
Mani Rangu is sa ri ma pa ni sa sa ni pa ma ga re sa. So close, right? Yeah.
Sometimes Vrindavani and Vrindavana Saranga are used interchanged. And of course there are other ragas which are very close, very similar. Say for example, Rudra Priya. Sa re ga ma pa da ni sa sa ni pa ma ga ri sa amba para devate ar Rudra kopa vira Rudra kopa jata vira. So there are, so it is very close to Pushpalatika. Sa re ga ma pa ni sa sa ni pa ma ga ri sa ikanaina. Or even Purna Shadja. Sa re ga ma ni ni sa sa ni pa ma ga ri sa. So very close. So we have to be very alert. So some of the other close ragas like Purna, I've already told Purna Shadja, Manohari, Jayanta Sena, Shuddha Bangala. So there are lots of ragas, Janyas of Karahara Priya and Harikamboji, which are very similar. They differ just by a note, or even that note will occur in a vakra way. So there are lots of ragas. So we have to prepare for all this. Janaranjani, Purnachandrika, Bangala are allied ragas, like you asked me to talk about them. So Janaranjani, the arohanam, avarohanam, or even like some of the special phrases. Da na 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 na. Immediately it's Janaranjani. Da pa ni sa. So the arohanam is sa re ga ma pa da pa ni sa sa da pa ma re sa. This is Janaranjani. Purna Chandrika is sa re ga ma pa da pa sa sa ni pa ma re ga ma re sa. So which is, it's the same set of swaras, but in a different way. And of course, Bangala is sa re ga ma pa sa sa ni pa ma re ga re sa. There's a different version for the arohanam. Sa re ga ma pa ma re pa sa sa ni pa ma re ga re sa. Either sa re ga ma pa sa और सरी ग म प म री प स स नि प म रे ग रे सा. सो द स्टूडेंट हैज टू बी वेरी अलर्ट व्हेन ही इज लर्निंग सच रागास सो दैट ही हैज टू नो द संचारास हाउ व्हाट आर द स्वरास इन व्हिच ऑर्डर. सो ऑफ कोर्स लर्निंग कृतिज इन ऑल दीज रागास विल certainly the student can learn all the prayogas of the raga by learning kritis in the raga and listening to great masters and performing.
Also Shrikant ji, many rasikas want to know a little more about grahabedam. Of course there is a lot of material available now and in the net, and people are able to listen to great maestros and understand a little about grahabedam. But I know we have shared a lot about this during our travels and our concerts, and I've heard you say some interesting things about grahabedam, and I would like you to share them with us today if possible.
Certainly. Grahabedam is a shift of the basic sa of the shajja. So the shajja can be shifted, the position can shift to ri ga ma pa da ni. So if the re is taken as shajja, but the scale remains the same, the arohanam avrohanam remains the same. So instead of sa from the lower shajja to the upper shajja and back, it can be lower rishabha to upper rishabha and back, taking re as shajja. And from gandhara to the upper gandhara and back, madhyama to the top madhyama and back. So it's a shift of the tonal shift, it's a shift of the shajja of the graha, that's why it's called grahabedam. So it is an interesting area in Carnatic music. G.N. Balasubramaniam sir was one of the pioneers in doing grahabedam, and of course his disciples Kalyan Raman, yeah, MLV madam and Kalyan Raman sir, they handled. But again, the grahabedam is a very tricky portion in a concert. It has to be handled. It's very lightly. You shouldn't be dwelling too much on grahabedam in a raga, in my opinion, because when we are singing, say for example, when we are singing Thodi, the Thodi has to be all pervasive all throughout the raga. So we don't want to, that's why I think some of the very traditional older musicians, they never ventured into grahabedam. It's not because the Thodi, any raga has its own unique flavor and bhava. So if we do grahabedam, we are sort of changing the way the raga looks. We are changing its total contour and everything. So, but I'll still talk about grahabedam. So, for example, we've spoken about Thodi. So, sa pa sa sa ri. So, I'll just sing the plain notes instead of the gamakas to be more clear. Sa ri ga ma pa da ni sa. Sa ni da pa ma ga ri sa. So from re to re, re ga ma pa da ni sa ri, ri sa ni da pa ma ga ri. So now we make this re as sa. Sa, sa ri ga ma pa da ni sa. Sa ni da pa ma ga ri sa. Kalyani. So the grahabedam from Rishabha in Thodi is Kalyani. So similarly from Gandhara. Sa ri ga ga ma pa da ni sa ri ga ga ri sa ni da pa ma ga 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 ma pa da ni sa ri ga. Na 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 sa ri ga ma pa da ni sa sa ni da pa ma ga ri sa. Harikambuji. So similarly we can keep doing for madhyama, panchama, daivata. So from madhyama it is Natabhairavi. From panchama it is dvimadhyama thodi, like you have no panchama dvimad, the ragas that Shri Thanjavur Kalyan Raman sir popularized. Oh. So that thodi is called Hanuma Shri. So it's I'll simply sing the other ragas also. Sa re ga ma ma pa da ni sa re ga ma ma ga ri sa ni da pa ma sa sa re ga ma pa da ni sa sa ni da pa ma ga ri sa nata bai ravi pa then. So I'll sing from the lower octave pa. Sa ni da pa pa da ni sa re ga ma pa pa ma ga ri sa ni da pa. So this is the dvimadhyama raga is telling about. Pa sa sa re ga ma ma da ni sa sa ni da ma ma ga ri sa. There is no panchama. So from the daivata it is Shankarabharanam. Sa ni da da ni sa re ga ma pa da da pa ma ga ri sa ni da sa sa re ga ma pa da ni sa sa ni da pa ma ga ri sa ni ni sa re ga ma pa da ni ni da pa ma ga ri sa ni sa re ga ma pa da ni sa sa ni da pa ma ga ri sa karahara priya. So this is another very interesting aspect here is, so the order here now for Thodi, if Thodi is the base raga, Shajja, from Rishabha, for Rishabha it is Kalyani, for Gandhara it is Harikamboji, for Madhyama it is Natabhairavi, for Panchama it is Hanumashri, for Daivata it is Shankarabharanam, for Nishada it is Karaharapriya. So the order is Thodi, Kalyani, Harikambodhi, Natabhairavi, Hanumashri, Shankarabharana, Karahapriya. This order remains the same if we take any other raga. It's a very interesting thing. So suppose your base raga is Kalyani. Sa re ga ma pa da ni sa sa ni da pa ma ga ri sa re ga ma pa da ni sa ri ri sa ni da pa ma ga ri sa re ga ma pa da ni sa sa ni da pa ma ga ri sa Harikambodhi. So after Kalyani, the order is Thodi, Kalyani, Harikamboji, Natabhairavi, Hanumashri, Shankarabharanam, Kararapriya. So for Kalyani, Ri is Harikamboji, Ga is Natabhairavi, Ma is Hanumashri, Pa is Shankarabharana, Da is Kararapriya. Again the cycle, Ni is Thodi.
This is so interesting. Is it possible for you to explain this concept a little more for the sake of students? And is there any easy way to try to do this?
Yes. I'll explain the Grahabhedam concept better with a chart, so it's more obvious for the students. So this is the chart. I've written all the 12 notes. Sa, Ri 1, Ri 2, Ga 2, Ga 3, Ma 1, Ma 2, Pa, Da 1, Da 2, Ni 2, Ni 3, Sa. So the notes in Thodi are the first, the second, the fourth, sixth, eighth, ninth and the 11th. So I'll, for simplicity's sake, I can represent Thodi by the numbers 1, 2, 4, 6, 8, 9, 11. So these are the notes that occur in Thodi. So if you do Grahabhedam for Thodi, if you start from Ri, the Grahabhedam, so the Ri becomes the Sa. So it's obvious from the chart that we'll, instead of Ri, we'll replace the Sa. Instead of Ga, it'll be Ri. Instead of Ma, it'll be Ga. So, and we'll also, the Swarasthanas, we'll leave the exact gaps that are in between. So for example, between Ri and Ga, there is a gap. So similarly, when we are doing Grahabhedam, between Sa and Ri, there will be a gap. So and so it will be a, it will follow exactly whatever gap is there. For example, between Ma and Pa, there is a gap. So we will give a gap similarly between
the
Ma and Pa.
Gap.
The same gap, whatever is there, we will give. So if a student does this for himself, he will understand this better. And like I've told earlier, the ragas, for Thodi, from Rishabha it is Kalyani, from Gandhara it is Harikamboji, from Madhyama it is Natabhairavi, from Panchama it is Hanumashri, and then Shankarabharanam and Karaharapriya.
Yeah.
Of course, a lot of artists have done, Balamurli sir has done a lot, Lalgudi sir has done a lot on this. So
yeah,
exactly, yeah. And graha bhedam is more difficult on an instrument than an vocal, because say for example on a violin I can imagine ga as sa, but still my position will be, I'll be playing gama pada, but I have to think as sarigama, which is easier in a, as a vocalist you can just easily switch your mind for that sa and adjust and sing a happy from Todi. You can sing a happy Kalyani, or you can even sing a derivative of Kalyani like Mohanam, or even Mohana Kalyani, or any of the ragas which others have sung. So it's,
how do we do that? Can you just explain from
we
Todi?
Skip notes, yeah, from Todi. Sa re ga ma pa da ni sa, re ga ma pa da ni sa re, sa re ga ma pa da ni sa. Instead of that, re ga ma da ni re re ni da ma ga re. So we have skipped sa and pa. Mm-hmm. We have omitted sa and pa.
Yeah.
So sa re ga pa da sa, sa da pa ga re sa. Yeah. So we can even play sa re ga pa da sa, sa ni da pa ma ga re sa. Mohana Kalyani we can do. So but again the question is, we'll be employing a different set of gamakas for Kalyani.
Yes.
And a different set of gamakas for Todi. Is it really apt to sing a gamaka that is not really Todi, just for the sake of doing graha bhedam?
Yeah.
So that's a question that needs to be dwelt upon by the artists. Mm-hmm. So and there are lots of, for it's very easy for pentatonic scales to do graha bhedam, say for Hindola or Mohana. Mm-hmm. So you get lots of, you know, Shuddha Saveri, Madhimati and all those ragas. Mm-hmm. It's very easy. And it's a very interesting topic, and I'm happy to share my views about that. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Srikanth ji, for explaining about the allied ragas and the graha bhedam for us. And going out of your comfort zone and singing for us, I requested you specifically because it's easier for the students to understand the swaras that way. I hope we have you playing for us in ACJ in a few episodes. Thank you so much.
Certainly. Thank you.
Namaskar. So, what we saw now definitely tells us that the raga quotient of our music is so expansive that it is not possible for us to talk about everything in an episode like this. However, this is just to increase the curiosity. We have just dwelt on a few aspects, and I am sure students and rasikas will look into it more deeply. As they journey through different concerts, they will understand more and enjoy this aspect of our concerts. Of course, we have the Swarakalpana, the Nerival, Ragam Tanam Pallavi and other beautiful aspects of our Manodharma, which we shall talk about in the coming episodes. For the moment, thank you so much for being part of A Carnatic Journey. We'll see you soon in the next episode. Namaskaram.